today to the internet. Millions of people order flights or books or other goods online, talk to their friends online, download music, all of it when they want to, not when the shop or the office is open. This Google generation has moved beyond the idea of 9 to 5, closed on weekends and bank holidays. Today's technology is profoundly empowering. And of course, public services are different and their values are different. But today, people won't accept a service handed down from on high. They want to shape it to their needs and the reality of their lives. And the same global forces that are changing business are at work in public services too. New ways of treating, new ways of teaching, new technologies. There will be no selective trust schools or city academies. But if, as at the academy I visited in Lewisham, good GCSE results are doubled in a year, and a school once undersubscribed, now 5 times oversubscribed, how is that a denial of public service values? Surely it is the most vivid affirmation of them. And if an old age pensioner who used to wait 2 years for her cataract operation now gets it on the NHS in an independent treatment centre in 3 months, free at the point of use, that is not damaging the values of the National Health Service. It is fulfilling its purpose. My advice at the next election: the issue will not only be who is trusted to invest in our public services, vital though that will be, it will be who comes first. And our answer has to be the patient, the parent. Meeting the 18 weeks maximum for waiting in the NHS, with an average of 9 weeks from the door of the GP to the door of the operating theatre, booked appointments, that is the end of waiting in the NHS. Historic. Transforming secondary schools in the way we've done for our primary schools, schools with 3/4 of the children getting good results, the norm, that would be historic. Both are within reach. Do this, and we will have earned the right to be custodians of our public services for the next generation. But if we fail, and without change we will, then believe me, change will still be done, but in a regressive way by a Conservative Party. I want change true to progressive values done by a fourth-term Labour government. Well, I always said the Home Office was the toughest job in government, and it hasn't got any easier. We should get a few facts straight. Under this government, crime has fallen, not risen. We're the only government since the war to do it. Asylum applications are dealt with faster, removals are greater. The system, infinitely better than the chaos we inherited in 1997. But the fact is, the world is changing so fast that the reality we are dealing with, mass migration, organised crime, antisocial behaviour, it's simply engulfing systems that were designed for a time gone by. 30 million people now come to Britain every year. Visitors, tourists, workers, students, and our economy needs them. 227 million pass through our airports. Yet we have no means of checking who is here lawfully. The fundamental dilemma is this: how do we reconcile liberty with security in this new world? Let me say something to you. I don't want to live in a police state or a Big Brother society or put any of our essential freedoms in jeopardy. But because our idea of liberty is not keeping pace with change in reality, these freedoms are in jeopardy. When a crime goes unpunished, that is a breach of the victim's liberty and human rights. When you have organised crime gangs free to practice their evil, countless young people have their liberty, often their lives, damaged. And when antisocial behaviour goes unchecked, each and every member of the community in which it happens has their human rights broken. When we can't deport foreign nationals, even when inciting violence, this country is at risk. Immigration has benefited Britain. But I know that if we don't have rules that allow us some control over who comes in, who goes out, who has a right to stay and who has not, then instead of a welcome, migrants find fear. We can only protect liberty by making it relevant to the modern world. That is why identity cards using biometric technology are not a breach of our basic rights. They are an essential part of responding to the reality of modern migration and protecting us against identity fraud. A small example, but an important one. I remember when I first introduced the DNA database, and on it go all those who are arrested and come into contact with the criminal justice system. We were told it was a monstrous breach of liberty. It is now matching 3,000 offences a month, including last year several hundred murders and thousands of rapes and other violent offences. Difficult reform, but leading to real progress in the fight against crime. In the next parliamentary session, the centrepiece will be John Reid's immigration and law and order reforms. I ask people of all parties to support them. Let liberty at last stand up for the law-abiding citizen in this country. And of course, the new anxiety is the global struggle against terrorism without mercy or limit. This is a struggle that I believe will last a generation and more. But I also believe this passionately. We will not win until we shake ourselves free of the wretched capitulation to the propaganda of the enemy that somehow we are the ones responsible. This terrorism isn't our fault. We didn't cause it. It's not the consequence of foreign policy, it is an attack on our way of life. It is global, it has an ideology. It killed nearly 3,000 people, including over 60 British, on the streets of New York before the war in Afghanistan or Iraq was even thought of. It's been decades growing. And its victims are in Egypt, Algeria, Indonesia, India, Pakistan, Turkey, over 30 nations in the world. And it preys on every conflict, and it exploits every grievance. And its victims are mainly Muslim. This is not our war against Islam. This is a war fought by extremists who pervert the true faith of Islam. And all of us, Western and Arab, Christian or Muslim, who put the value of tolerance, respect and peaceful coexistence above those of sectarian hatred, should join together to defeat it. It is not British soldiers who are sending car bombs into Baghdad or Kabul to slaughter the innocent. They are there, along with the troops of 30 other nations, with, in each case, a full United Nations mandate, at the specific request of the first ever democratically elected governments of those countries, in order to protect the people against the very ideology also seeking the deaths of British people in planes across the Atlantic. If we retreat now, hand over Iraq to al-Qaeda and sectarian death squads, Afghanistan back to al-Qaeda and the Taliban, we won't be safer. We will be committing a craven act of surrender that will put our future security in the deepest peril. And of course it's tough. And not a day goes by or an hour in the day when I don't reflect on our troops with admiration and thanks, the finest, the best, the bravest any nation could hope for. They are not fighting in vain, but for this nation's future. But I know this is not a conventional war. It can't be won by force alone. It's not a clash of civilizations. It's about civilization, about the ideas that shape it. And from 9/11 until now, I've said again and again, if we want our values to be the ones that govern global change, we have to show that they're fair, just, and delivered with an even hand. From now until I leave office, I will dedicate myself, the same commitment I've given to Northern Ireland, to advancing peace between Israel and Palestine. I may not succeed, but I will try, because it is right in itself and because peace in the Middle East is a defeat for this terrorism. We must never again let Lebanon become the battleground for a conflict that neither Israeli nor Lebanese people wanted, though it was they who paid the price for it. And peace in Lebanon would be a defeat for this terrorism. Action in Africa is a defeat for terrorism. And what is happening now in the Sudan cannot stand. If this were in the continent of Europe, we would act. Showing an African life is worth as much as a Western one. That might help to keep terrorism too. And yes, it's hard sometimes to be America's strongest ally. And yes, Europe can be a political headache for a proud sovereign nation like Britain.